The GPD WinMax 2. We covered that device quite a lot already, and we're not done yet. We've got an eGPU. Let's go. Now, I would like to start by saying that while we are indeed using the GPD WinMax 2, these series of tests are really about any device sporting a USB-C 4 and a Ryzen 6800U. That's not to say that you couldn't see slight variations, but for the most part, it should be relatively the same. For our eGPU, we are using a Razer Core X. While this is not a review of that particular product, here's to some B-roll so you can feast your eyes on it. It comes with a USB-C cable, a power cable, the enclosure, of course, that which contains a logic board and a 650 watt power supply. The power supply can push up to 500 watt to the GPU and keeps 150 watt to supply the device that serves as the brain of the operations, which in this case is our trustworthy WinMax 2, and power the fans, helping to keep our GPU cooled. Talking about GPUs, we'll be testing a 1660 Super, a RTX 3090, both pair with a Intel i9-9900K, and of course the 6800 APU with its integrated Radeon 680M. It is well known that a 3090 as an external GPU solution is overkill, but how much power can we still get from it, and how much do we actually leave on the table? This is precisely what we want to find out. And to do that, we have four tests to go over. Furmark, which is a stress test, this gives us a very direct GPU representation with no CPU involved whatsoever. And then we ran benchmarks from the following games, namely Shadow of the Tomb Raider, Red Dead Redemption 2, and GTA 5. And I do have a little bonus by the end to share as well. Now, before we start, let's go over a few things. A quick story, a disclaimer, and a short tech talk. For the ones looking to jump straight into the numbers, I'll put a timestamp on screen. Story first. After which, I wouldn't blame you if you thought, wait, is this guy serious? See, this is my first time ever touching, seeing, or let alone using an eGPU. So originally, I ran my test with both screens being duplicated using both a monitor and the WinMax 2's panel. Keep in mind, I didn't research any of this, but I did have an epiphany after 3-4 minutes of testing and had the good conscience to try closing the panel from GPD's device. And that nearly doubled my FPS. So my interpretation to do this in the first place was that logically, that creates more bandwidth going through the USB-C cable. And in doing so, performance is greatly impacted. And that turned out to be true. Again, I'm sure this is a well-documented fact, but I'm putting it out there for the ones who, just like me, may be using an eGPU for the first time. Don't expect to play through your device's screen, as you'll massively lose performance. And when it is plugged in, I recommend not keeping your device's panel opened, or at least don't display the games through them in any way, otherwise, bye-bye performance. And of course, don't use any other HDMI DP out other than the ones on the GPU themselves. Duh. End of story. Disclaimer next. I should make this known, I am using an EVGA, now gone but not forgotten, FTW33090. That card needs 3 8-pin connectors, however this eGPU only has 2. So I used this splitter to fix this issue as the card refused to boot with just 2 connectors. These are a necessary risk to take, but should you decide to replicate what is being done in this video, know that I am in no way responsible of any potential outcome. I did prioritize higher gauge cables, which I'll link below if you wish to buy the same. But yeah, the takeaway is that it will require some tweaking, and then by doing that, you are creating risks that your cable receives too much power load, overheats, melts, or straight up malfunctions. I'd recommend against it, but yeah, now you know. As for our short tech talk, I really enjoyed putting this video together, and I'd be curious, once you guys have watched it, what you'd like to see next or that you think was missing, etc. With that said, make sure to leave in the comment box any suggestions, recommendations, or constructive criticism for next times. So right, this eGPU business is looking bright, because really from a logical standpoint, we can be met with 3 potential bottlenecks. Number 1, the size of the bandwidth. So the size of the bandwidth is very important, as pushing more data than the cable can withstand will result in performance loss. And while I've established from my testings that we do meet that threshold, we barely do with a 3090. Number two, data speeds. This is a major change between Thunderbolt 3 and 4. As TB3 and TB4 both support the same total amount of bandwidth, DB4, however, moves in much faster ways. And while TB3 and USB 4 are theoretically capable of same speeds, it seems that TB3, being Intel's proprietary protocol, outperforms the royalty-free USB 4 protocol. Fun fact, the USB 4 was essentially donated by Intel. Now, data speeds is by far the biggest bottleneck we will meet, and is also why you don't want to be running a game on your WinMax 2 screen. Doing so will clog your speed throughput and impact performance. Number three, and this one is theoretical, but I'm pretty sure we hit that bottleneck pretty aggressively in some of these testings. It is fairly common for games to move data around from hard drive to VRAM, but also to RAM and moving things around between them. In a PC architecture, all those components share bridges, so the data moves at amazing speeds. When using an eGPU, if your VRAM needs to dump data into your RAM and vice versa, it would logically add a high count of data on the USB 4 protocol, effectively reducing both your bandwidth size and speed capabilities. This will make sense a little later in the video. All right, onto the video now. Let's first have a look at FermArc. Here we see the GPU really scaling positively with the eGPU versus without, and surprisingly, we barely leave anything on the table with the 1660 Super. In fact, we nearly almost match 100% performance regardless of resolution. That, to me, means that in the right conditions, the 1660 Super could potentially be used at 100% if just for total bandwidth size alone. But of course, we'll hit other bottlenecks along the road. The 3090, on the other hand, is able to show a bit of loss, which is hard to determine if it's because of bandwidth size or speed or a mix of both. But with that said, the 3090 also does scale extremely well with the eGPU, with the highest recorded loss being at 720p. It matches the desktop's performance to 89.76% of its efficiency. That is absolutely amazing and is bright for the future of eGPUs as the technology grows. So moving to our first game title, GTA 5. Now, things start becoming a little more interesting as we see a greater impact on how hard our USB-C cable has to work to merge the data. For the 1660 Super, we see an average of 83.39% of our PC performance between all resolutions. The worst in our testings was at 1080p with 78.94%, and the least at 4K with 90.47%. That is a great example of how our bottlenecks can drastically change the performance that we get using an eGPU. The 3090 is met with an obvious bottleneck through the entirety of these benchmarks. The average stayed within 3 FPS from being at 720p all the way to 4K, while even on PC we most likely had a CPU bottleneck as well. With that said, the 3090 gives us an average of 78.96% performance versus being used on a PC. But with 4K specifically, it is 82.11%, leaving less than 20% performance on the table. Not bad at all. Next, Shadow of the Tomb Raider. This one was extremely interesting. Again, we'll have some pretty obvious bottlenecks with the 3090, but if we focus on the 1660 Super for a minute, see how little loss we have in 1440p and 4K. I am led to believe that it can handle the bandwidth size, but when met with needing faster information, as in much more frames per second, as we see in 720p and 1080p, the hit is pretty huge in comparison. Because keep in mind, a 1080p signal is far less data than what whatever comes next. But more frames per second also means that the information, albeit smaller, needs to be carried at a much higher speed. Similar to how your TVs and monitors will have much less latency at higher frame rates than lower. So while our average loss in performance across our resolution is only less than 19%, 81.87 to be exact, we see a much larger gap with 720p being 66.92%. That's huge. 33% loss in performance, whereas 4K is 88.57%. But 1440p did best here with 92.42%, less than 8% loss in performance. Incredible. The 3090 is about to hurt big time. We met an average of 37% loss versus the PC, 4K being the least affected by it. That is a game where I'd expect Thunderbolt 4 to do much better at 720p, 1080p, and 1440p. I would think, however, that 4K would result to about the same performance, but yep. The 3090 is undoubtedly overkill here, as it was in our previous game. But wait for the next one, you are going to cry. And have a look at this. And guys, I tested 3-4 times because I just couldn't believe the results. The PC is doing fine here, but look at our eGPU performances. We are getting 24 FPS across the board. So I wondered, what the hell could be the cause of this? And I came to this conclusion that this game probably heavily moves data around between RAM and VRAM. That's my only logical explanation. It couldn't be a bandwidth size and or speed issue, otherwise we'd see variations, but instead we have a pretty consistent 22 to 24 FPS on both the 1660 Super and the RTX 3090. But my curiosity pushed me even further. I thought, maybe a particular graphic setting is causing this. So to make sure I was not making assumptions too hastily, I decided to do another string of tests, that one at 720p with everything at the very lowest and with FSR on performance. And this is what came up. Playing locally on the WinMax 2 without GPU more than doubles the performance of the eGPU. That's just mind-blowing. So that's how the RAM and VRAM theory came about. And Red Dead Redemption 2 is known to have a living world, meaning that events can occur even if the player is not there to see them. That would cause a heavy load on CPU, and CPU data would be handled by RAM. Now, RDR2 is a beautiful game. What we see is for our GPU and VRAM to handle. But if we use an eGPU, well, then the Ryzen 6800U will reserve its LPDDR for CPU uses exclusively, and the GPU will rely on its VRAM. And to prove this theory, I did one last thing. I decided to run the benchmark again, running exclusively from the WinMax 2's panel. That gave me an average FPS of 36. I then decided to run the benchmark with both panels on duplicate, 32 FPS, and that left me only one thing for me to do. Run the game using the Radeon 680M, but through the eGPU's HDMI out to display my game on my monitor. Because if we get any different numbers, this is the absolute proof that USB-C bandwidth limitation is not the cause of those odd numbers I've been getting. Lo and behold, this gave me, after running the benchmark twice, an average of 76 FPS. Boom. So this is the third bottleneck I was talking about. And to be honest, Red Dead Redemption 2 is most likely to be a huge exception here. But yes, this might be a repeated notion if VRAM RAM is heavily exchanging data, though to be honest, I doubt there are many games where this could be such an apparent issue. I mentioned the bonus, guys. I thought, what better opportunity to test Portal RTX? While running locally on the PC using the 3090, I managed 31 FPS average at 4K. With the 3090 and its eGPU enclosure, 29 FPS average. That 2 FPS difference is well within variable range. Logically, from the way ray tracing works, I don't expect eGPUs to impact ray tracing specific performance. At least on NVIDIA GPUs because of RT cores. Ray tracing is far more sensitive to bandwidth speed than it is about bandwidth size, but it also makes its calculations within the GPU before the data is pushed out to your monitors. Theoretically, having ray tracing on would not be affected by the eGPU itself, but more so by whatever the card is able to output. My point is, if you are leaving 30% on the table at a specific resolution, and ray tracing reduces your FPS by 15%, there is theoretically no reason for the hit to suddenly be 45%. Rather, it should remain at the 30 that you were already expecting, which brings me to my conclusion. A 3090 is way overkill, but we all knew that. If you have one laying around though, try playing in 4K, you'll greatly minimize your impact. This seems to be the case for any modern GPU. While I don't think we did hit bandwidth speed bottlenecks with the 1660 Super, I do think we weren't that far off. However, that would be resolved with Thunderbolt 4 if that's the setup you are going with. If we are talking about the setup with which we tested today, I'd say a 2070 Ti or a 3060 Ti are probably the sweet spot for USB 4e GPUs at the time being. When 4060 will be released, you might get a bit more performance, but hardly. What I would expect, however, is a considerable jump in ray tracing enabled games. Now, before bringing this video to an end, a quick mention to the Razer Core X, which, as of the time of making this review, is heavily discounted on their website, especially for Canadians. Yay! I'll leave a link below if you want to see for yourself. A bit of warning, know that the Chroma variant offers expansion USB-As and an Ethernet port. If today proved anything, the more data you push onto your USB-C cable, the less performance you should theoretically have. I'd recommend against the Chroma for that reason. And so this brings us to the end of our video. Working with an eGPU was actually a lot more pleasant than I thought it was going to be. And where I thought it to be a waste of time, I now see that this is a viable option to dock certain devices and get great gaming performance. I hope this was insightful to you guys. Let me know in the comments what device you'll be using your EGP enclosure with, and maybe you're not there yet and actually in the market for that device, in which case I'd love to suggest my GPD WinMax 2 review to see if that device seems appealing to you. Cheers!